us through the wilderness and give us grace for trials and tests. The Holy Spirit shows the way and in our weakness teaches us to pray. We'll worship in the wilderness, a dry and thirsty land. We won't survive by bread alone, but by your word and guided by your hand. As Jesus fasted 40 days, so help us turn from selfish ways to trust in you and learn to give. For when we die to self, we'll truly live. We'll worship in the wilderness, a dry and thirsty land. We won't survive by bread alone, but by your word and guided by your hand. You join us in our brokenness and comfort us in our distress. For you're the hope of all who mourn. You lead us to your resurrection door. Worship in the wilderness, a dry and thirsty land. We won't survive by bread alone, but by your word and guided by your hand. We'll worship in the wilderness and trust the path you've planned. You're faithful in the wilderness, and by your grace we'll reach the promised land.
Take my life and let it be dedicated to your praise. Lord, I freely give to you every moment of my days. Take my hands to show your love for the broken and the lost. Guide my feet to follow Christ in the shadow of the cross. Take my voice and let me sing, always only for my King. Take my lips and may they always bring you praise. I'm all yours, I'm all yours, my Lord, all I am, every part. I'm all yours, I'm all yours, my Lord. Take my life, take my heart, take the things that I possess. I surrender all I own. Lord, I give my every thought to be ruled by Christ alone. Take my voice and let me sing, always only for my King. Take my lips and may they all I'm all yours, my Lord. Take my life, take my heart. Take my life and let it be dedicated to your praise. Lord, I freely give to you every moment of my days. Take my hands to show your love for the broken and the lost. Guide my feet to follow Christ in the shadow of the cross. Take my voice and let me sing, always only for my King. Take my lips and may they always bring you praise. I'm all yours, I'm all yours.
Good morning, folks. I know it's Lent, but I'm sure you can do a bit better than that. Good morning, folks.
Good morning.
There we go. There we go. We have entered the season of Lent. I read a meme, one of these things on the internet that said, this is the season of Lent, the season where a group of grumpy people give up chocolate and coffee and they're all coming to your church. I'm sure that's not true for us here. Good morning and a very warm welcome to Ellen Parish Church. This morning, my name is Alistair Bruce and I'm the minister here in Ellen Parish Church. You are most welcome if you've been here. If this is your first time, you're most welcome. If it's your 100th time or 1,000th time, then you are most welcome as well. We record the service for catch-up, and so if you don't want to be on camera or if you're running from the law and you don't want to be caught on camera, then stick near the back. I'll leave you to work out the folks that are at the back. But we should put the service should be up at some point later on for catch-up. As I said, we're in the season of Lent. This is the season that's known for giving stuff up. But Lent, of course, has a deeper meaning than that. It's supposed to be a time for self-examination, for saying sorry, and for study. And the period of Lent lasts for 40 days. Although if you work out Lent from Ash Wednesday to Holy Week, the end of Holy Week, then that's more than 40 days. It's because you don't count Sundays. You get Sundays off from Lent, because on a Sunday we always celebrate the resurrection. So we always get to take a wee break on a Sunday from Lent. So Lent started on Ash Wednesday. We had our Ash Wednesday service to start Lent. Over this season, over this period of Lent, that kind of self-examination that Jesus did when he spent 40 days in the wilderness is what we mirror during this season of Lent. And so over the season of this Lent, we're going to be thinking about the theme of wilderness and how that relates to our faith and to our lives. So let's just take a little moment as we still our hearts to worship God. If you're splashing in streams of abundance, we welcome you. Share your joy. If you're parched in a desert wasteland, we welcome you. Share your doubts. If you're relaxing in the light of contentment, we welcome you. Share your peace. If you're stumbling on the road of suffering, we welcome you. Share your pain. God of water, earth, light, and brokenness, we welcome you as you welcome us. So let us worship God together, singing the hymn, Christ, our hope in life and death. So there's a couple of intimations, a couple of notices that I'd just like to highlight for you this morning. The main one really is that I got a message from Craig Walker, the captain of the BBs, who's saying that they're looking for helpers for anchors and junior sections. So those two sections that meet on a Wednesday. Basically, it's one officer and a couple of youth helpers, some of the company boys that are helping in fact most weeks. So they're looking for another adult helper to help out with anchors and juniors. If you're interested in that and think that you could give a wee bit of time to help with that, anchor starts at 5:30, finishes at 6:30. Juniors is 6:30 till 8:15. If you think that you could do that, or you know somebody who you think would be interested in helping out with that, you can either come and speak to me or you can let Edith know in the Kirk Centre office, and she'll pass you on all of those details. If you know Craig's number and his email address, then just get in contact with him directly. But maybe the easiest way is either the office or me. Remember that the cookbook is available. CDs are available as well. CDs that we made during lockdown of some of the hymns that we did then. And the Team Leaders Hub meets this week on Thursday evening at 7 o'clock. There's no Star Squad Wednesday this week because of the school strikes. Alpha is this evening, and Life Group, even though the Life Group on Friday was last Friday, it's this Friday coming because you had a slight change of date. I think that's all I need to remind you about this morning. Sandra is going to come up and tell our Bible story. And Anna is ill, otherwise she would have been here already beating you. But if you want to come up and join in the Bible story, then up you come.
Switched on, whatever you want to call it. No, it's a pity Anna's not well, isn't it? Well, we give her a wave in case she's watching, going to be watching later on and catch up. Say, get well soon, Anna. Yeah, good. Right, our story today. Oh, we're very low in numbers today, aren't we? Oh, gosh, you coming, Logan? Come away. Right, our story today is called Farmer Gideon's Men. The people of Israel were hiding. They hid in caves, they hid in the hills, they were hiding from men on camels. The men on camels came riding into the promised land from beyond the river, the Jordan River. They took away the sheep, they took away the cows, they took away the donkeys, and they trampled on the corn as soon as it was planted. Oh no. Why did God let them do that? God still loved the people of Israel, but they had broken their promise to love him and to live as he wants. The people of Israel had no wool, they had no milk, they had no bread, and they were afraid of the men on camels. There were too many of them to count. Help, help, please help us, they cried to God. And God answered them. You have broken your promise, God said. Yet now that you are in trouble, you want me to help. And I will help, because I still love you. God went to find Farmer Gideon. I have a special job for you, God said. You must rescue my people from those men on camels. But I can't fight them, Farmer Gideon objected. I'm a farmer, not a soldier. You can if I help you, God said. The men on camels came riding in again from beyond the river, the Jordan River. Too many of them to count. Then Farmer Gideon blew a long blast on his trumpet. Remember your trumpets from last week? He was calling for help, and the men came running. Too many, God said. Tell the ones who are scared to go home. Still too many, God said, as Gideon watched them go. take the ones who are left to the stream to drink. Well, that's a bit strange, isn't it? The ones I want will cup their hands and lap like dogs. That way they can keep a look out for danger. The rest of them can go home. Can you imagine? They're drinking at the river, and when they cup their hands and take the water up, you lap and your eyes can still scan around and see where you're going. So it makes it safer for them. That left just 300 to fight the men on camels, who were too many to count. That night, God said to Gideon, "Get up, it's time to go." Gideon gave every man a trumpet. He gave every man a flaming torch and a jar to hide it in. All was quiet. They crept up close to the men on the camels, who were still fast asleep. Now Gideon's men were all around the camp. Doo-doo-doo-doo! Doo-doo-doo-doo! What was that terrible noise? Gideon's men were blowing their trumpets. What was that blaze of light in the dark? Gideon's men had broken the jars that hid their flaming torches. The men on camels woke up in such a fright. They were so scared, yes, their knees were knocking, that they leapt on their camels and fled away.
Well, that was good.
That was good, wasn't it? That was so good. So, will we now say a little prayer? Heavenly Father, thank you that you are with us every step of the way, whether rich or poor, strong or weak, clever or not so clever. Help us to have willing hearts and be humble but brave in spirit. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen. And now will we say the family prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Well done. Thank you all for joining me. And now we are going to have the children's song, which is the Jericho song. So you all ready to do your actions? You're going to do your actions? Yeah.
Drowning out the lies of the enemy. We're turning up the anthem that sets us free. Your mighty name will ever be the soundtrack of our victory. We're lifting up your praise like a battle cry. The thunder of your name breaks apart the night. Your matchless grace will ever be the soundtrack of our victory. Our God, you will tear down the walls. Our God, you are invincible. Strongholds crumble like castles of sand as we shout loud our Jericho song. Church alive, we're fighting on our knees with revival fire. Our King shall reign and ever be the soundtrack of our victory. Our God. Every wall is crumbling, is tumbling down. Every wall is crumbling, is tumbling down at your name, Jesus. Every wall is crumbling, is tumbling down. Every wall is crumbling, is tumbling down. Every wall is crumbling, is tumbling down at your name, Jesus. Oh God, you
morning is from Deuteronomy chapter 8, verses 1 to 5. Do not forget the Lord. Be careful to follow every command I am giving you today, so that you may live and increase and may enter and possess the land that the Lord promised on oath to your ancestors. Remember how your God led you all the way in the wilderness these 40 years, to humble and test you in order to know that in your heart whether or not you would keep his commands. He humbled you, causing you to hunger, and then feeding you with manna, which neither you nor your ancestors had known, to teach you that man does not live on bread alone, but on the very word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. Your clothes did not wear out, and your feet did not swell during these 40 years. Know then in your heart that as a man disciplines his son, so the Lord your God disciplines you.
Thank you, Joyce. Let's pray together. Our loving God, as we come to consider what it is that you want to say to us this morning, we pray that you be in our hearts and in our heads. Open our minds to receive from you. Open our hearts to receive your Holy Spirit and to receive what it is you want to say to us this morning. So may these words be your words. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So about 2.5 weeks ago, something really unusual happened in a small university in the southern state of Kentucky in the U.S. At a normal student chapel service in Asbury University, the students spontaneously stayed in worship. When the service had finished, the worship didn't. They carried on, continuing to worship. Evidently, it had come from one student feeling like they wanted to confess some of their sins to a group of friends, another group of students. And the student body president, a lady called Allison Perfetter, said that the moment that that happened, the atmosphere changed. She said this, "For seemingly no reason at first, on Wednesday, February 8th, it didn't end. What's been happening here since Wednesday is there's a young army of believers who are rising to claim Christianity, the faith, as their own, as a young generation and as a free generation. And that's why people cannot get enough." So there has been worship happening in Asbury University ever since, 24 hours a day, ever since that moment. At one point, according to the media, there were tens of thousands of people visiting and wanting to attend these evening services. Apparently, they've now closed it to the public, and it's only people that are at the university that can go to these services now. They describe some of the features of what they're calling the Asbury Revival of 2023. Some of the features are that it started amongst younger people, those folks that are not normally associated with Christianity, not normally associated with the church. And apparently it's very calm. There are no flashing lights. There is no mass hysteria. There are no praise bands. There's no organ. There's no preacher whipping the crowd up. And there doesn't even appear to be somebody leading the services or one particular person leading the services. It's all incredibly calm. The founder of an organization called 24/7 Prayer, a guy called Pete Gregg, he described it like this. He says, "What's happening in Asbury is not everything, but it is something. Right now we need something to shock the system so that this generation can experience for themselves the life-changing power of God. We need repentance and holiness." Some of the hallmarks of revival are things like a sense of delight, a sense of joy. A revival in the church, a revival in Christianity, is a mountaintop experience. When we have these mountaintop experiences, often, well, pretty much 100% of the time, after we have these mountaintop experiences, we have to come back down again. We have to come back into the valley. We come back down into the desert, into the valley, into the wilderness. We experience the highs of things and then we come back down. And that's often the hardest part. And it'll be interesting to see what happens when this part of the Asbury revival finishes. How has it actually changed the lives of those young people when they go back down into the valleys and when they have to live out their faith in that kind of desert and wilderness? But we all experience these kinds of things in our lives. So we all experience great highs, mountaintop highs, and then lows. For example, if you're married, if you've been married, then you know what it's like. You experience the wedding and the honeymoon, and then you have to learn to live with the person. And you go down into the valley of realizing, can you live with the person that packs the dishwasher like this for the rest of your life? If you're a parent, then you know that having a baby is full of elation. You're delighted and full of love and joy for this little bundle of fluff. But then you go down into the valley of sleepless nights and dirty nappies and colic and teething, and then they start moving and all of that kind of stuff. You're in that sort of wilderness bit down there. If you're retired, then you'll have experienced the high of that last day of work, of that celebration of the last day of work, and then that glorious, I believe, moment when you realize you don't have to get up anymore to go to work. You don't have to get up in the morning. You can do whatever it is that you like. But then you get that wilderness of, all right, well, what am I actually going to do with this new stage of my life? What am I going to do now that I'm retired? And you'll have that sort of valley moment. Or sometimes it's just the simple joy of the elation of the weekend and the wilderness of Monday morning. And maybe for the Scotland rugby supporters, we'll have the elation of France, and then we might go into the valley of, well, we'll just see what happens at 5 o'clock this afternoon. Often we live our lives between mountaintop and valley moments. Lent is a valley moment. Last week we talked about the transfiguration, that moment that Jesus was on the mountain when he was transfigured, when he was gleaming full of glory. Now we go down into the valley of the wilderness, into the valley of Lent. And what we're going to do over the next few weeks, over the period of Lent, is that we're going to explore what wilderness looks like in our lives and in our faith. And sometimes it can be a bit different to how we think wilderness is. The writer, Jenny Phillips, describes it like this. She says, "The wilderness in the Bible is a liminal space, an in-between place where ordinary life is suspended, identity shifts and new possibilities emerge. We learn that while biblical wilderness is a place of danger, temptation, and chaos, it's also a place for solitude, nourishment, and revelation from God." And so as we take our first steps into the wilderness, we're going to go back to a moment and a phrase that we explored during Epiphany. We did it at the end of Epiphany and we did it at the start of Epiphany. And we're going to explore a wee bit further about what happens after that. And Joyce is going to come up again and read that bit from Mark's Gospel just now.
Our second reading this morning is from Mark chapter 1, verses 9 to 13, the baptism and testing of Jesus. At the time, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. Just as Jesus was coming out of the water, he saw heaven being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. A voice came from the heaven, "You are my Son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased." At once the Spirit sent him out into the wilderness, and he was there in the wilderness for 40 days, being tempted by Satan. He was with the wild animals, and the angels attended him. Thanks be to God for his word.
So we've got this phrase again, where God speaks to Jesus and says, "You are my Son, whom I love. With you I am well pleased." We have the elation of God speaking this over Jesus. And immediately following the high of Jesus' baptism and Jesus being commissioned in this way, Jesus is led into the wilderness. And the first thing to notice about Jesus being led into the wilderness is this. It says, at once the Spirit sent him out into the wilderness. Jesus is led by the Holy Spirit into the wilderness. He doesn't just wander into the wilderness by himself. He doesn't just have some kind of... He doesn't just decide himself to do it. He doesn't just find himself there. He is led very purposefully by the Holy Spirit into the wilderness for a purpose and for a reason. There's a reason why Jesus is there. Growing up, Wednesday nights were quite exciting. I have very low standards. Wednesday nights were very exciting for me growing up because I was allowed to stay up past 9 o'clock to watch the TV show MASH. It lasted for about 25 minutes or half an hour. It was very exciting for me to be allowed to stay up on a school night past 9 o'clock. I remember one episode of MASH where the unit's chaplain, a guy called Father Mulcahy, tried to talk to a wounded soldier who had been severely traumatized by what he'd witnessed on the front lines of the war. And when the soldier discovers that the father has never actually seen active service, he's never actually been in a direct war situation, he concludes that he has nothing that he can say to him. He refuses to talk to him. He's not interested in the platitudes of somebody who hasn't gone through anything, who hasn't experienced that. Later on in the episode, we find Father Mulcahy under enemy fire, and he has to perform an emergency procedure while being bombed and under explosions and enemy fire. He goes back to talk to the man again and finds that because he has gone through this experience, the man is open to hearing what Father Mulcahy has to say to him. They now have a frame of reference, and they now can talk because he knows that the Father gets it. This is one of the reasons why Jesus is led into the wilderness. This is one of the reasons for Jesus' trip into the wilderness. If Jesus had never experienced the jagged parts of life, if he had never experienced the hard and grueling and exhausting bits of life, then how could he speak into any parts of our humanity? How could he speak into our lives and the lives of the people around him if he hadn't gone through anything? How could Jesus talk about God's kingdom and what it's like to be part of God's kingdom if he had never experienced life out with God's kingdom? The writer and priest Henry Nguyen writes in his book, The Wounded Healer, he says this, he says, who can save a child from a burning house without taking the risk of being hurt by the flames? Who can listen to a story of loneliness and despair without the risk of experiencing similar pains in his own heart or even losing his precious peace of mind? In short, who can take away suffering without entering into it? This is what Jesus does by entering into the wilderness. He experiences suffering. He experiences the valleys of life so that he can speak into that to people. Something else as we go on with this wilderness story. Something else about Jesus in the wilderness. Mark writes this. Mark says, he was with the wild animals and the angels attended him. The wilderness can be a lonely place. Sometimes it might feel when we're in those moments that God has abandoned us. It can sometimes feel like we're on our own. But this simple promise says something different. It says that Jesus didn't go into the wilderness alone. It says that the angels went with him. And when we go into the wilderness, we're promised that we're not there on our own, that we're not there ourselves, that we go with support. We're not alone. Which is a really lovely sentiment. It's really comforting, and on the surface of it, it's quite helpful. And to just give you a wee bit of an insight into the way that I put sermons together, this was the point that I stopped. This is the point in writing the sermon last Wednesday when I started this that I stopped. And I could not write any further because I realized that was a platitude. That was something that, unless I explained it more, wouldn't actually mean anything. And so I spent 2 days staring into space trying to work out what this actually meant for us. What does this actually practically mean? How does the promise that we're not alone in the wilderness actually work in the proverbial wilderness of depression or illness or work stress or crippling uncertainty about who we are and whether we're worth anything? How does that promise actually work in our lives? Well, I found two short phrases from two theologians and thinkers and writers that I think helps with this. So the first quote is from a man called Eugene Peterson, and he wrote this. He said, "When we want to let the life of Christ make a revolutionary impact on our life, we go to the desert." So, to just explain that a little bit, our not aloneness in the desert is tied to our discipleship. It's tied to letting Jesus make an impact into our lives. It's tied to opening ourselves up to what it is that Jesus is going to do in our lives. If we want to not feel alone in the wilderness, then somehow we need to open ourselves and be aware of what God is doing in our lives and allow that to change us, to actually change our lives, to actually and tangibly change us. If we spend no time out with an hour or so on a Sunday morning engaging with our faith, then how can we then feel not alone in those wilderness times? Because we have no other point of reference or no other point of relationship with Jesus. So our feeling not alone is tied to our discipleship, which is a challenge for me as it is a challenge for everyone else. It's a challenge to think beyond what's on the surface. So that was quote one that I thought kind of helped. Quote two is from the Old Testament scholar and theologian, a man called Walter Brueggemann. And Walter Brueggemann says this. Walter Brueggemann says, "Wilderness is a place in biblical rhetoric where there are no viable life support systems. Grace is the occupying generosity of God that redefines the place." And so again, let me just unpack that a little bit, because there's a whole lot of jargon in there. So I'll give you what I think this means. In ancient Israel, in the times of ancient Israel, there was a period where the Israelites were wandering around in the desert. They had gone through the Red Sea, and then they were looking for the Promised Land, and they spent 40 years wandering in the wilderness, in the desert. The first reading we heard from Joyce this morning explains a bit of that, talks a bit about what that was. There was nothing for the Israelites to eat. They had no food with them. They didn't know how to survive. The place was empty. There were no viable life support systems there. And what the story of the wilderness wanderings tells us is that God provided the food for them, provided a thing called manna, which fell from the sky. Every day it would fall from the sky, and there was enough for them to eat. It was a sort of bread-like substance. And this was what they lived on. It was by God's grace that he did this for them. He gave them manna, and he changed the wilderness from a place where you couldn't live into a place where they could live. And it was all because of this manna, because of this thing that God provided for them. Which makes me think, for us today, what is God's grace-filled manna for us? What is that thing that helps us in our lives? And I think for many of us, that God's grace-filled manna is things like being sure we're loved, is being sure that we're noticed, it's being assured that we've made a contribution to the world. It's making sure or having the assurance that we are worth something, and that possibly that everything is going to be okay in the end. I think that's where that manna comes from. And I genuinely think, that this community, this place that we're in at the moment, has the power to be that manna to do all of that. A community that is built on Jesus, on his teachings, on his life, made up of people who really know and are opened up to living the life, living into the teachings of Jesus and mirroring Jesus' life in our lives, has the power to literally change people's lives. I think that's how we get that support. I think that's what that manna is. To be surrounded by a community where we are genuinely loved and welcomed and cared for and noticed can be life-saving. I'm not saying that this community is perfect and that we do all of that. We fail all the time with that. But if we strive towards it, then we're getting to that place. But I think that can only happen when we let Jesus change us, when we let Jesus influence the way that we live our lives, and when we change from being passive observers of an organization that we're kind of disconnected from into being full family members who nurture and grow and support and lean on each other in times of darkness and allow each other to minister to each of us. It's not the job of the so-called leaders of the church to do that. It's the job of everybody here to do that for everyone else. And the Bible calls that thing, he calls that thing a cloud of witnesses. And we simply call it the church. It's a community of people who actually strive towards love and tenderness and generosity and compassion and intentionally live our lives differently to the self-centered rules of the world. I think that's a sign of God's grace working in the wilderness of our lives. And I think that's how the angels attend us when we're in the wilderness, if we are open enough to let that happen. The singer and songwriter Andrew Peterson, in a song called All Shall Be Well, writes this. He says, "And the night can be so, so long, you think you'll never get up again. But listen now, it's a mighty cloud of witnesses around you. They say, hold on, just hold on, hold on to the end." My prayer this Lent is that if you're in a wilderness place, that you hold on. That you hold on to those folks who are around you. You hold on to Jesus and you open yourself up to what he can do in your lives through your faith. Here around us is the cloud of witnesses. Here around and between us is God's grace. And you know, I just wonder whether it was that kind of loving community of God's grace that led one student in a university in Kentucky to feel comfortable enough to confess his sins to a friend that started a revival that's continuing even till now. Let's pray together. Loving God, may we open ourselves up to what it is you want to do for us, with us, in this wilderness time. May we be open to wildernesses in our lives, and may we seek you through them. Loving God, be with us through your Holy Spirit and through the grace that exists between fellow believers. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So in response, as the band come up and lead us in a song or two, it's really simple or to explain. It might be slightly more tricky to do, but I want you to come up and pick up a little card slip from the basket at the front that's got a Bible verse on the back of it. They're generally different Bible verses. What I want you to do is to take this away and to pray about who to give this to. So who, after you've read this Bible verse and prayed, who are you led to encourage with this Bible verse? I want you to think about a person who could do with that encouragement and give that away to that person. My confession is that they are really badly cut out, so if you want to tidy them up, then please feel free to do that. There might be a blank one or two in them as well. That doesn't mean that God isn't speaking to you. That just means that I photocopied a couple of blank ones. So if there's a blank one, just put it back in and pick another one. So just spend a little bit of time in prayer as the band leads us, and then when you feel ready, come up and pick up a card and then think about who to give that away to.
Truly live.
us in our distress. For you're the hope of all who mourn. You lead us to your resurrection dawn. We'll worship in the wilderness and trust the path you've planned. You're faithful in the wilderness, and by your grace we'll reach the promised land. We'll worship in the wilderness and trust the path you planned. You're faithful in the wilderness, and by your grace we'll reach the promised land. Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering, though there's pain in the offering. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
Let's pray together. Lord, sometimes we feel like we're walking through wilderness. Jesus, we choose to walk with you. When our spirits feel dry, help us to trust in your spirit. Jesus, we choose to walk with you. Fasting seems difficult, prayer seems unanswered. Jesus, we choose to walk with you. The world howls like wild animals all around us. Jesus, we choose to walk with you. We can choose to worry or to trust you to provide. Temptation is everywhere. Doubts can overwhelm us. You know what it's like to walk through this desert. Jesus, we choose to walk with you. Loving God, you long to transform us with wilderness worship. Jesus, we choose to walk with you. Amen. So we continue our worship singing the hymn, All the Brown and Bare Horizons. Dedicate our offerings and ourselves back to God. Let's pray. God of the wilderness, we give these offerings in gratitude, rejoicing in the abundance of your gifts to us. We give these offerings in faith, trusting that you will provide for our needs. We give these offerings in hope, knowing you can use them to spread your love in this world. And with these offerings, we give ourselves. May we live with generous hearts, with open hands. Amen. And now Ron's going to lead us in our prayers for others.
Let's pray again together. O Lord, throughout these 40 days, you prayed and kept a fast. May we do the same, repent and turn to you. Be with us through all we face and free us from the past. Give us strength that is joy. We may follow you and see the mystery of your grace shining through at last. Lord of all being and source of every blessing, we thank you for all good things, for life and love, for health and food, for work and home, for nature's beauty and comfort, for human skills and laughter, for memory and hope, and for everything in this past week which has given us pleasure, nourishment, and strength. Loving God, remember this night the whole human family, especially those who hunger for food or justice, Those who lack homes or human dignity. So many are unknown to us, yet each known to you, and each a child of your love. Remember your people in every part of the world, redeemed by Christ, dedicated to service, called to love. Remember your church in this place, set in this community, to light the way to your grace and truth. And Father, we pray for our ministry team, our session, and our eldership as they seek ways to refresh and renew this discipleship within our church. We pray that decisions and discussions made are done prayerfully and for the benefit of all in our community. Loving Lord, remember those who are ill or sorrowing, those who are concerned for dear ones, those who have difficult choices to make, especially any known to us, whom we now commend to you in the quiet of this place. May they know that nothing can separate them from your love in Christ Jesus. By your mercy, bring us at last with all your faithful people to the peace and joy of your nearer presence. God, our Creator, by your mercy and might, the world turns safely into darkness and returns again to light. We give into your hands our unfinished tasks, our unsolved problems, and our unfulfilled hopes, knowing that only those things which you bless will prosper. To your love and protection, we commit one another and all for whom we have prayed. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Thank you, Ron. And so remember that there is tea and coffee and home bakes and all of those kind of things. And then over on this side, there's the Save a Loaf and all of the kind of food waste stuff that we try and reduce over on that side. So check out that. Stick around for tea and coffee and to spend a little bit of time together chatting. So let's sing our last hymn together, hymn number 336, or up on the screen behind me, Christ is our Light.
Thank you.
So go from this place as you walk through the wilderness of Lent. Go from this place to be that cloud of witnesses, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and all who you love and all those you find it more difficult to love this day and forevermore.
Trials and tests, the Holy Spirit shows the way, and in our weakness teaches us to pray. We'll worship in the wilderness, a dry and thirsty land. We won't survive by bread alone, by your word and guided by your hand. As Jesus fasted 40 days, so help us turn from selfish ways to trust in you and learn to give. For when we die to self, we'll truly live. In our distress, for you're the hope of all who mourn. You lead us to your resurrection door. We'll worship in the wilderness, a dry and thirsty land. We won't survive by bread alone, by your word and guided by your hand. We'll worship in the wilderness and trust the path you've traveled. You're faithful in the wilderness, and by your grace we'll reach the promised land.
I'm all yours, my Lord. Take my life, take my heart, take the things that I possess. I surrender all I own, Lord. I give my every thought to be ruled by Christ alone. Take my voice and let me sing, always only for my King. Take my lips and may they always bring you praise. I'm all yours, I'm all yours, my Lord, all I am, every part. Take my life, take my heart. Take my life and let it be dedicated to your praise. Lord, I freely give to you every moment of my days. Take my hands to show your love for the broken and the lost. Guide my feet to follow Christ in the shadow of the cross. Take my voice and let me sing, always only for my King. Take my lips and may they always bring you praise. I'm all yours, I'm all yours, my Lord, all I am, every part. I'm all yours, I'm all yours, my Lord, take.